Good afternoon. I believe I have the great honor of calling us to order as we return from lunch. I'm sorry to interrupt. The vibrancy is palpable and admirable. My name is Brian Vivier. I'm the director for the Center for Global Collections here at the Penn Libraries. And it's been my great honor to moderate this panel, Medicine 2. We have two speakers this afternoon. I'll introduce them each in sequence, and then we'll open for questions with our remaining time. First up in Medicine 2 is Petros Bouras-Vallianatos. Oh, I've inadvertently, no. I'm bad with technology, so you know, I assumed it was my fault. Professor Bouras-Vallianatos is Associate Professor of History of Science at the University of Athens. He comes to us as a specialist in Byzantine medicine, and I'm excited to say that he has a recent publication, the book Innovation in Byzantine Medicine, out on Oxford University Press in 2020. He'll be speaking to us this afternoon on unknown protagonists in Greek medical manuscripts, paratexts as conveyors of medical knowledge. Please join me in welcoming Professor Bouras-Vallianatos.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for the kind introduction, and also I would like to thank Lynn for the invitation and also for this wonderful conference. I mean, I have been enjoying a lot the fact that we discuss broad medieval topics, and there are scholars from a wide variety of backgrounds, and especially from different traditions in Asia and Europe. So it is important always when we discuss these topics to have to contextualize them across Eurasia. And this is one of the very few opportunities that we have this. And I would like to emphasize this and congratulate Lynn for selecting such prominent speakers. Okay, today I'm going to speak about an Arabic Greek medical translation and its textual transmission. And so the fact we have the translation as a concept, and then we can see translation at further levels, mostly as in the form of paratexts, and how medieval scholars try to explicate the text and enhance its readability to medieval audiences. So whether added by scribes when copying a manuscript or by later hands, paratexts are often important elements in the transmission and understanding of complex medical theories. The study of medical paratexts in Greek manuscripts has not received any significant attention to date, and scholars are often perplexed as to how to describe and study the various categories of data involved. So the first part of this talk examines various kinds of marginal notes and will take into consideration a variety of characteristics, including their place on the folio and the manuscript, their function, when this material was added to the codex, and the identity of the scribe. The second part aims to introduce a new notion to the study of medieval medical manuscripts, the hidden or dynamic, what I call paratext, that is the inclusion of additional material in the main text prior to or at the time of copying. My talk is part of a wider project on medieval Greek medical paratexts, which includes evidence from a large number of manuscripts. Today, I have chosen to focus on one manuscript, Vaticanus Graecus 300, for several reasons. So it is quite a large manuscript, 31 by 24 centimeter, and lengthy parchment codex consisting of 344 folia. It has never been studied in detail as far as paratexts are concerned, although it is rich in such material. It contains some texts that have been very little studied and is the earliest surviving witness of some important Arabo-Greek medical translations, such as the Ephodia to Apodimundos, the Greek translation of the provisions for the traveler and nourishment for the sedentary, by the 10th century physician and medical author Ibn al-Zazar, which was widely circulated in late Byzantium and remains unedited in Greek to date. This text occupies 266 folia, and there are also excerpts from Gellin's On Critical Days, Theophilos's On Urines, and the Greek version of an Arabic treatise, which is entitled On Purgative Drugs. The latter is ascribed to St. John of Damascus, but is most probably by the 9th century author Uhana ibn Masawi, better known in the West as Mesue. Additionally, one finds several brief anonymous opuscules on diagnosis and therapy of diseases. Lastly, according to Santo Luca, the Italian paleographer who has very closely studied this manuscript and the various scripts, the manuscript was copied by 1130 to 1140 in the area of Reggio in southern Italy, or in Messina in Sicily, and is one of the earliest surviving witnesses of the so-called Reggio script. Thus, studying this manuscript can provide us with important insights into the medical activity of Greek-speaking physicians in the multicultural milieu of this region. This is also important in decentralizing the study of Byzantine medicine and including evidence from other places other than Constantinople. To return to the script of the codex, the Italian paleographer Luca has identified four different main scribes active in the copying of the manuscript. And there are also four additional hands that annotated the codex in the margin or in the main body of the text. Luca has convincingly argued for the identification of hand D, small letter D, with that of the most likely commissioner of the codex, a physician from Reggio called Philip Xiros. From references in this manuscript and in a recipe book which survives in Parisinus Graecus 2194, we know that Philip was from the area of Reggio and was the father of another physician, Nicholas Xiros. He was also most probably connected with a Greek-speaking physician from Sicily called Euphemios, according to the title of the recipe book, which I quote, book containing recipes compiled and tested by the most marvelous Euphemios of Sicily and Philip Xiros of Reggio, both among the marvelous physicians. Philip is also known as one of the witnesses to a charter recording a donation to the Greek monastery of the Holy Savior at Bordonaro to the south of Messina in April 1135. This was written on parchment and is preserved nowadays together with other documents from Messina in the archive of the Ducal House of Medina Celi Foundation in Seville, in Spain. Thus, we can assume that Philip moved from Calabria to Sicily as part of a more general migration of specialized Greco-Calabrian personnel encouraged by the Emperor Roger II following his coronation in 1130. From my research, I have discovered that Vaticanus Graecus is an exceptional, actually, copy of the Ephodia, often elaborated with additional material showing the personal involvement of Philip Xiros himself. Today, due to restrictions of time, I will focus only on paratexts clearly connected with Philip Xiros and his son. However, it is worth mentioning that the codex has two kinds of marginal paratexts in terms of the nature of the material. First, there are lengthy marginal texts in a formal hand identified with that of the main script A, which contain entire passages from another text. These have been copied in selected parts of the text to explicate certain theories discussed in the Ephodia and are part of the late antique commentary by John of Alexandria on the Hippocratic work Epidemics, which has been edited by John Duffy. Secondly, there are marginal or interlinear notes added by informal hands, including that of Philip Xiros. For the purpose of this paper, I'm defining a note as a statement of variable length from one word to several sentences connected to a more or less well-defined section in the main body of the text. The various categories that I'm going to present are based on the function that the note is designed to fulfill. The first group includes statements signposting the reader through the contents of the codex. For example, quite often, Philip recommends his readers to look at other recipes found in Paul of Aegina's medical epitome, a 7th century medical handbook, which remained extremely popular throughout the entire Byzantine period. On folio 244 verso, he refers to the chapter on erysipelas in Paul's work. This note attests to the use of other medical texts by contemporary physicians in southern Italy and Sicily. At the same time, Philip creates a complementarity between the Ephodia and Paul's text, which didn't exist in the original Arabic treatise. The second group contains interesting sets of recommendations with supplementary information on certain recipes or details about a particular therapeutic procedure connected with the administration of a drug, thus enhancing the codex's usefulness to practitioners and readers derived from Philip's own practical experience. For example, on folio 173 recto, we read, first of all, seek to purge. On folio 72 recto, where the text refers to the dosage of some lozenges for spitting of blood, he adds, quote, let them, idest the lozenges, be swallowed while fasting, which is not found in the original Arabic text. I would like to thank Fabian Kiss, who is currently preparing a critical edition and translation of the Arabic text, which, and he was able to confirm that. Furthermore, on folio 27 recto, Philip recommends his son not to administer medicines that can be smelled, perhaps referring to medicines in the form of incense, since ingredients such as roses, camphor, musk, and other similar ones, according to Philip, would strengthen the stomach. The advice is related to the contents of the main text, in which a certain recipe is given in order to purge the stomach. The intended addressee of this note is clearly his son. Thus, I shall call this a private paratext. That is a paratext addressed to a specific individual. Of course, later on, it could be consulted by other readers of the manuscripts and became a public paratext, but it was initially designed as an intimate note between two members of the same family. And it could be perhaps seen as supplementary material connected to an ongoing apprenticeship, enabling Philip's son to gain the required theoretical and practical knowledge. The third group of notes is related to the provision of synonyms in Greek, intended to familiarize the reader with the Arabic terms that have been given in Greek transliteration, the main body of the text. For example, in the margin of folio 198 recto, Philip adds two synonyms in Greek for the Arabic term given in Greek transliteration in the main text. The Greek synonyms are balsamon and sisymbrion, which are both terms used for species of mint. The Arabic term nemem, a transliteration of one of the medieval Arabic words for mint, namam, is marked in the text with an asterisk. The adverbs aravisti or sometimes sarakinisti are used to denote the Arabic version. Sarakinisti derives from the adjective sarakinos, Saracen, which is used in medieval Greek sources as a term for Arabs or Muslims. This example is an emphatic reminder of the gradual dissemination and reception of the translations of Arabic medical texts throughout the Mediterranean from the 11th century onwards. Having given some examples of marginal paratexts, I shall now discuss what I term dynamic or hidden paratexts. For example, there are several additional recipes by Philip that have been included by the scribes in the main body of the text in various chapters of the translation, thus constituting an integral part of the euphodia in this witness. These recipes would not have been printed or included in a conventional critical edition, or at best some of them could have been provided in the apparatus criticus or in an appendix to the edition, thus not adequately representing the various additional layers, reductions of the text. In this case, these recipes are a rare testimony to Xerossi's personal engagement with this copy of the euphodia, and also gives us a glimpse of the medicines that were most probably used by Philip in daily practice. It is not clear whether the scribe copied the material from an existing copy of the euphodia, which included the recipes by Philip, from one of Philip's notebooks, or whether the recipes were added under Philip's guidance during the copying of the text of the euphodia in Vaticanus Graecus 300. Let me give some examples which will help us to further elaborate my point. In book 3, chapter 13 of the euphodia, on heart palpitations, there are two additional recipes by Philip Xiros. The first reads, I quote, "Recipe of an electuary. I, Philip, the least of physicians from Reggio, added this recipe. Since I found it, took it, and learnt from past philosophers, that it is beneficial for violent heart palpitations. I tried this several times, and I pleased my patients. Take with God's blessing bugloss flowers." At the end of this recipe, he adds a further note for a potion made with bugloss for the treatment of melancholy and heart affections, ending as follows. Quote, "It is beneficial for melancholy and heart affections, as Philip Xiros, the physician, and your father tells you, son." Having cross-checked with the original Arabic version of the work, I have established that these are definitely additions by Philip. Interestingly, once again, Philip addresses his son, Technon, also a physician, in a didactic yet intimate way. We can also deduce information about daily practice from these recipes. For example, in these two recipes on folio 90 recto, to 91 recto, there are references to zedoary, cube pepper, ambergris, red and yellow sandalwood, thus making them the earliest attestations to the use of these particular Asian ingredients not previously used in Byzantine recipes. Even more interesting, however, is the recipe for a sugar-based potion on folio 300 recto. It is worth mentioning that Greek and Byzantine authors used honey as a sweetener and preservative in composite drugs. Sugar became extremely popular as an excipient in liquid pharmaceutical dosage forms in the Islamic world. Among the most popular forms were zulaps and syrups. While sugar is used in robes and could also be used in enemas, pills, and pastilles. Sugar-based potions did not become regular items in Byzantine pharmacological manuals until the early 13th century, as I have recently argued in a publication in Speculum. In the recipe for a sugar-based potion with bugloss on folio 300 recto, or Vaticanus Graecus 300, one particular intervention by Philip provides us with an interesting testimony to the use of the new substance. Quote, since this is beneficial for the melancholic diseases and for those with heart affections, as the physician Philip Xiros, who is also your father, says, O my son Nicholas, do not add the ingredients and the sugar to the prepared juice when very hot, nor when very cold, but when there is a moderate temperature in both directions. The preparation instructions in the recipe clearly show that Greek physicians had experience of using sugar by the early 12th century in southern Italy. It is worth remembering that unlike Constantinople and other cities of the Byzantine Empire, in southern Italy and Sicily, sugar was readily available. In fact, the plant had been cultivated in Sicily and sugar produced there from as early as the 10th century. The last example I would like to discuss is related to uroscopy. In the last part of the codex, where there are brief opuscules on a variety of subjects, there is one basic account of the various kinds of urine. These kinds of anonymous treatises are very often found in Byzantine manuscripts, and they are intended to give details about diagnosis and prognosis of disease based on different types of urine in an aphoristic manner. The one here is entitled On Urine Signals and starts by providing some details on the production of urine and the various states of human digestion. Then it goes on to discuss seven colors found in urine. In the next part, on the three traditional areas of the urine vial, Philip's advice is encapsulated in the following statement. Quote, as Philip Xiros, the physician, and your father says, the vial is divided into three parts. The part floating at the top of the urine is called cloud. The one in the middle of the vial is called suspension, and the one at the bottom of the vial is called sediment. The text then goes on to discuss further distinctions in the colors and so on. In my view, Philip's intervention here is not coincidental. Philip's advice acts as an emphatic pointer to his son concerning the most fundamental feature of the most important medieval diagnostic and prognostic technique of the age and highlights the significance that the various areas of the vial played in every single case. Here you can see a nice diagram of the vial divided into three main areas in the 15th century Welcome Manuscript MS, MSL 16. To sum up briefly, we have seen that by examining a few examples of paratexts in this manuscript, which mainly contains translations from Arabic into Greek, we can deduce a good deal of information about the reception and understanding of a text. In this case, a newly introduced Arabic text in Greek translation. Furthermore, by looking carefully at each witness of a certain text, one can discover several layers of composition, interpretation, explication, including additional material added by physicians and scribes in the form of hidden paratexts. In Philip's case, he clearly invites his readers to share his own reading and understanding of the text and enter into his own world of thought and medical practice. Most interestingly, he expands the original Arabic text in a variety of ways to facilitate comprehension and resolve any ambiguities, thus adapting the Arabic medical tradition for a new audience. Thank you.
Thank you, that's wonderfully exciting. We move now to our second paper, that by Andrew Berns. Andrew Berns is returning to us. He holds a Penn PhD from 2011, and we're also happy to promote his recent book on Penn's Press, just out now, called The Land is Mine. Andrew Berns is a professor at the University of South Carolina. He works on Iberian Jews, Bible commentary, and the environment. Today, he'll be speaking to us on They Are Always Prone to Illness, Letters of a Young Jewish Physician in the 16th Century Italian Countryside. Please join me in welcoming Andrew Berns.
Thank you, Brian, for the introduction. And I want to join the chorus of people who have thanked the incredible staff here, especially Lynn Ransom, for organizing what has been, to my mind at least, a flawless conference in every way, intellectually, logistically, socially. Thank you. Okay. Good. I want to speak today about a collection of letters from early 16th century Italy. And given that I am a technological dinosaur, I have printed out a handout. Well, Lynn has printed out a handout that I've sent her. So I have a few slides, and I'm going to refer to the letters that are in front of you right now. So apologies for encouraging your attention to be divided. I didn't want to put that much text up on a screen. So you can listen to me and look at the letters and also look at the images as you like. The letters I'm going to speak to you about today come from a technically undated and anonymous collection of Hebrew letters from the early 16th century. They were written by someone named Solomon. We know this from context clues and the labors of later bibliographers. And his letters date from between 1514 and 1517. He lived in the town of Morlupo, which I haven't even indicated here. It's in the upper red rectangle just there. So we're in central to northern Lazio, about 30 kilometers north of Rome. And he moves to an even smaller hamlet called Stimiliano, and that's represented by the lower red square. And he talks about the transition from one place to the other in the letters. My goals today are several. I want to talk to you a bit about the daily lives and professional challenges of a physician working in a rural context. Historians of medicine have told us much more about the urban activities of physicians and much less about their rural lives. I want to speak about class very briefly, as he, Solomon, the author of these letters, mentions the laboring classes in and around Stimiliano and their tendency to always fall ill. And I want to say a bit more about what I'm going to loosely term riparian medicine, the issues that arise in and around river valleys and rivers themselves, and talk a little bit at the end to tie this all together about the connections between rural medicine, riparian treatments, and what it means to write about all this in a classical language like Hebrew. Okay, Stimiliano, I've taken this from a recent Italian atlas to give you a sense of how close it is to the Tiber River. So,
Stimiliano is there, and the Tiber makes that big bend right by the town of Stimiliano.
And there's a good aerial photo of what it looks like, not an unpleasant place for sure. There's Morlupo, about 18 kilometers north of Stimiliano, not situated on a river, but I wanted you guys to get a sense of the mise en place of the areas where Solomon worked. Okay, let me say a few more words about Morlupo and Stimiliano socio-politically to put this into a better frame. Solomon, like a number of young physicians, would have been hired by a local lord or magnate to serve as a community physician. And at this time, Morlupo was under the control of the Orsini family, a powerful Roman clan with deep roots all over what is today Lazio. And although we don't know specifically who was the lord of Morlupo, research indicates it may well have been Franciotto Orsini, who died in 1534, was a cousin of Pope Leo X, and whose father was Orso Orsini. This is a little bit of insider knowledge for the few people in this room who know something, or probably more than a few, who know something about late 15th and early 16th century Italian politics. Franciotto was educated by none less than Lorenzo de' Medici, and he was named Protonotariato Apostolico in 1514, the first year We have a letter from Solomon, and in July of 1517 was named cardinal. So moving on to, oh, by the way, that's more Lupo, not also not an insignificant place as far as aesthetic considerations go. So the manuscript I'm going to talk about today is from the Lorenziana Library in Florence. It's Pluteus 8812, and this is just a quick exterior shot of the binding. And here's what the letters themselves look like. This is an image from the first letter that I'll be discussing with you today. Fortunately for me and other scholars, excerpts from these letters were published in the 1990s by Jacob Boxenboim, and he has released 7 volumes that contain letters from Renaissance and early modern Jewish writers writing in Hebrew. Boxenboim is very selective and made quite a few mistakes in his transcriptions, which I had the fun of revising and correcting against the Lorenziana manuscript. According to Umberto Casuto, the first person to seriously study this manuscript collection, it was almost certainly compiled over the course of several years. And to quote Casuto, the variety of characters and of ink, the presence of blank pages between letters, and the absence of any order whatsoever demonstrate that the collection was assembled gradually over time. A few words about the style here. This is written, as I'm sure you can tell from a cursory examination of the handout in front of you, in a very classicizing biblical Hebrew. There are relatively few post-biblical rabbinic phrases, although some. It's not easy or particularly delightful reading. It's such a pastiche of biblical verses that it doesn't really flow. And so the footnotes, which account for half of the page, mostly point you to the Bible verses that he's either citing directly or alluding to. And with regard to using these letters as a source for the history of medicine, the challenge is this: he's not going to use technical medical terminology that doesn't come from the Bible. So we'll talk about sores or fevers or spots, and all those terms are lifted straight from mostly prophetic and historical books of the Bible, or even from the Pentateuch when it comes to the plagues and the effects of them. So it's very difficult for historians of medicine to extrapolate anything diagnostic from these letters themselves. Okay, what I want to do in the next couple of minutes is essentially read you some excerpts that should be underlined on your handout, really for fun, and to give you a sense of the material culture and the medical insights that Solomon makes. So in this first excerpt, he is complaining about the locals, which is a favorite pastime of any physician in Renaissance or early modern Europe. And he says, quote, "They have no money to provide to a physician at their discretion, as I have seen in other places. To their minds, it is irksome to pay off a debt in its proper time. All this because they're indigent. They abandon physicians who were indentured to the community for months and years at a time, and they only pay them their wages at the end. Each doctor only receives a scant wage. This, their way, is their folly. The work is grievous to me because they do not call a doctor to their home unless there is a very great need and they are close to death. In that dire hour, they afford me much respect." Glad to hear you laugh. The first sentence here is a very typical complaint of European physicians at this time in general. And the second, ego-boosting affirmation, is not something that I see a lot, but I think it is humorous. On a more serious note, even worse, it is not the right season or time to practice this craft of medicine, to engage in it and make a profit, since at this time the pharmacists are barely concerned with the doctor and consider him scarcely at all, for this is their holiday. I have yet to receive any advantage from these pharmacists other than everyday things, but they have embraced me and I am quite dear to them. They tell me that if I were here in the summertime, which approaches us in peace — he must have written this in the spring, by the way — they would give me provisions. And that, by the way, is a word that he writes in Italian and Hebrew characters. He writes provisioni. Moving on to a second letter. By the way, both of these are written to a former teacher of his in Rome. Several of the letters were actually written to his fiancée, Bianca. And the second time we've heard the name Bianca today, I believe. Was it in your paper, Montserrat? There was a Bianca? Yeah. Sadly, when he writes to his fiancée, he doesn't seem to comment on things of medical import. So all of the quotations today are from letters to his former teacher. "This country is extremely busy, and they're always prone to illness. Since they plow their fields, and harvest their crops and perform all of their labor near and around the river. This is very bad for them and for their illnesses, so as to remove them from the world. And he's writing from Stimiliano. I want to go back to that slide if I can for a second and show you again the physical situation of it. So you can imagine how townspeople and rural laborers are in great proximity to the river. And I'll say more about riparian health problems in a second, but I just wanted to remind you of what Stimiliano looks like and where it's situated. Okay. Feel free to peruse the letters at your leisure. There is more to discover there. And I'm happy, of course, to answer any questions about any passages that you have in the Q&A. Okay, now to context. First, I want to talk a bit about civic doctors. By the end of the 13th century, the so-called Medici Condotti, or physicians hired by a community, are common in many Italian cities, northern, central, and even southern. And by about 1450, this is common practice throughout the Italian peninsula. Remuneration often depended on negotiation. Doctors were sometimes paid in kind, meaning with grain or with wine or with wood, and sometimes by being granted privileges of citizenship, which had to be purchased by an outsider. So in another place in the letter on your handout, but not on the screen and not that I read, he talks about the scarcity of wood and how expensive wood and bread are, which are clearly daily needs for any physician in this part of the world. There is also a class issue to be aware of when we speak of civic doctors, and that is that in many Italian principalities and cities, the communally salaried physicians often took care of the poor, while well-to-do physicians took care of more moneyed clientele. So it's clear to me from Solomon's complaints and from his tone that he's almost exclusively treating a more impoverished clientele compared to other physicians who were probably treating, for example, the Orsini family. And these complaints about sickness are ubiquitous by civic doctors, and they often complain, although Solomon does not directly, about other healing practitioners, women, people who don't have university degrees, astrologers, uroscopists, charlatans. So competition for patients and for patients who can pay are part and parcel of the world Solomon occupied. Moving on, I wanted to talk a bit about water. And I mentioned I was going to discuss riparian health a little bit. I wanted to signal boost briefly a new and dynamic project funded by the European Research Council called the Water Cultures of Italy, 1500 to 1900. And the scholars working on this are actually quite balanced chronologically and geographically between North, Central, and Southern Italy, and between 1500 and well into the modern period in the 19th century. So with regard to illnesses that arise in people who work in and around bodies of water like rivers, there are a number of genres that we as historians have access to. One is municipal statutes on water management and purification that tend to come from a number of Italian cities and towns. The second, and we heard about this earlier, the genre of the regimen vitae or the regimina vitae, are especially helpful for information about drinking water. It is a misconception, by the way, as David Gentilcore has recently argued, to think that nobody's drinking water in this period because it's unsafe. The misconception is that everyone's drinking wine or small beer, as it's called in England of this age. But in fact, Gentilcore shows people are drinking water ubiquitously, and physicians are writing very energetically and with a lot of detail about its medicinal properties. And third, an important genre that I'm sure all of you know about is literature on baths and springs, often referred to as De Balneis et Thermis. That's the title of many books on these issues. So Abigail Agresta, in her recent work on Valencia, has shown that the earliest plague treatises written right around the time of the Black Death focused on environmental factors that could make a city especially vulnerable to plague. And chief among them, I quote Agresta, who's citing a Valencian statute from 1348, chief among them was, quote, if a city had around it many swamps and channels or canals of unmoving water. And in Galenic medical theory, water that isn't moving swiftly corrupts the air around it, forming a toxic miasma that can often lead to disease. And concerns about stagnant or not particularly fast flowing water leading to bad air, leading to disease, is not at all unique to Aragon in Agresta's period, but is of course ubiquitous throughout Europe and especially in Italy as well. It's tempting for historians and historians of medicine in particular to attribute local outbreaks of disease near stagnant water to malaria or other mosquito-borne illnesses. But pools of stagnant water and the Tiber didn't always flow briskly. It depended on the season of year and the amount of rainfall, especially in the spring and fall. The Tiber itself could be a relatively stagnant body of water in this part of Lazio. These slow-moving bodies of water often smelled bad and looked foul, and because so much Galenic diagnosis, whether it's of a physical body or of airs, waters, and places, relied on visual stimulus, the mere appearance of water to not flow swiftly or to smell mephitic was a signal of its insalubrious quality. I have a section of my notes here about classical sources on water issues, which I'm going to skip over. I'm happy to talk about it more in the Q&A if you would like. Moving into the 15th and early 16th century, there is a small but considerable explosion of writings about baths and springs, not merely as sites of relaxation or classical otium, but also as treatment for a variety of diseases and illnesses, most notably perhaps Savonarola, not the one who you know of taking over Florence, but Michele Savonarola published a work called De Balneis et Thermis. Do I have a picture of it? Nope, I have a picture of another work that is a compilation from 1573 on baths. But Savonarola stresses the need that individuals have to analyze mineral springs in situ and to consider what a particular site of water will do for a particular illness. And Katie Park, among others, have written with extreme erudition about Savonarola and others. So while there are learned Latin compilations like this one by Tommaso Giunta, published in Venice, as I said before, and this one by the Roman physician Andrea Bacci on baths, we know basically nothing about the diseases of poor rural laboring populations in particular. And one of the things that's tantalizing to me about these letters by Solomon is they at least pay some attention, even cursory and even imprecise, to the fact that poor laboring people around the Tiber are falling ill, and this makes his life more difficult, because they're falling ill and because they can't pay him. And parenthetically, I want to say that in correspondence with Anne Carmichael, a leading historian of medicine in 15th century Italy, what stood out to her most about these sources, which I summarized and shared with her, is this mention of laboring classes that almost no physicians ever underscore in their writings. So I'd be curious to hear more from you as an audience of your impressions of these letters and my discussion of them, given this class-based exploration of patients. Okay, I'm going to move to my conclusions. I want to leave plenty of time for discussion of both Petros's and my work. So with regard to translation, what I am trying to do in this project is to think about multiple levels of translation that Solomon is engaging in, and at least two of them. One, we don't know where he learned medicine. I presume, given his writing style and his biography, that he would have attended a university medical faculty in Italy. That option was available to Jews, even in the very early years of the 16th century. In what was undoubtedly an extremely urban environment, he had to translate and transpose what he had learned about illness and disease that had a very specific urban focus to a rural atmosphere. So that's kind of translation step number one. And translation step number two, almost all of his medical knowledge surely came through Latin and possibly through the Italian vernacular. He's writing, even if nobody in this room reads Hebrew, you can tell, I hope, from my translation, that he's writing in a very classicizing Hebrew style. So these two steps of translation, urban to rural, and Latin slash Italian vernacular into classical Hebrew are quite provocative to me. And again, I'd be curious to hear what the rest of you think about those steps in translation. As far as my further work, as you can probably tell from the presentation, this is somewhat embryonic, and I was flattered and honored that Lynn asked me to come. And she said, do you have anything to say about a manuscript, for example? And I said, well, yes, Lynn. In fact, I've been working on this collection of letters. So as far as my own process moving forward, there are at least two steps that I was hoping to undertake, and I'd love to hear if you guys want to confirm that mission or complicate it slash add to it. One is to connect Solomon's Hebrew letters to other medical works from 16th century central Italy regarding the rural medical lives of patients. In medical responsa, the overwhelming majority of them published in Latin or written in Latin, even if not published, there are sprinklings of cases about peasant laborers and diseases of the poor in a country setting. So I think one fairly self-evident thing for me to do here is to pay more attention to those and see how Solomon tracks against other university-trained physicians writing in Latin. And the second thing that I intend to do is to go through more of these letters. As you can tell, it's sort of slow reading and not exactly light work, but to go through more of these letters that Boxenboim has published and the unpublished ones to pay particular attention to observations about rural life, even if not made by physicians, to see how Solomon compares either to other Hebrew language writings about the countryside or, as in my first point, to Latin and possibly Italian vernacular writings about rural diseases. Thank you for your attention, and I'd love to hear your responses.
Thank you so much. I feel like we've gone on a terrific journey here. We do have ample time for questions and discussion, and I'm thrilled to open the floor to all of you and right back on the right there.
Thanks, both. They were really fascinating. I just wanted to, Andrew, just a quick clarification. So could you just say a bit more about the Laurentiana manuscript? It's only Solomon's letters, or there are other letters? Is it common for people? Is it a manuscript written by him? Are they letters that have been bound together? Have they been recopied? Is that a common thing or an unusual thing for Hebrew doctors in this period? It'd be great to hear a bit more about that. Thanks.
Thank you. It was even in my notes, but I somehow skipped over that. I appreciate you asking. Can you all hear me? I'm not sure if this, you can. Great. No, the collection is not only Solomon's letters. It is a collection that consists of seven distinct corpora of Hebrew letters, all written by Italian Jews between 1500 and about 1530. Solomon's are the only letters in that collection that have to do with medicine. The letters are almost certainly not in his hand, but are in a later 16th century Hebrew hand. The hands in those seven letter collections are different. The hand in the collection Solomon comes from is the same. One final thing, I can't remember how you phrased this, but I'll answer in my own fashion. These letter collections have seldom been used by historians for a couple of reasons. They're hard to read, the style is very cumbersome, and they expunge systematically historically important data. For example, dates are not there, names are often crossed out. Everything that gets historians excited about material is absent from these letters. So I'm one of the, I think, relatively few people who's determined to mine these letters as a historical source, but it's a bit of an uphill battle. For example, even identifying Franciotto Orsini involves looking through 18th century Italian antiquary writing to see exactly where Franciotto Orsini held land at what time. So it's painstaking work, but I think there's a lot more to be done. And I was attracted to Solomon's letter collection because of his observations about medicine. And I need to do more to see how much additional material there is that's medical in nature. Thank you. Why are they collected? They're collected essentially as stylistic inspiration. These letters take so long to write and reflect such a laborious form of erudition. The notion is that other future letter writers will copy entire paragraphs, shifting only details. Rather than Bianca, it might be somebody else's fiance. So, and we know that some of these passages, not from Solomon in particular, but some of these passages that Boxenboim has published recirculate later in the 16th and into the 17th century. So basically they're stylistic guides, and there are plenty of these in Latin too, all the way back to the 15th century, I'm sure way back into the Middle Ages, how to say thank you for your letter 15 different ways. The same thing exists in the Hebrew culture of Italian Jews.
Mind if we grab a question from the Zoom? All right, this question is from Arthur Kieran. I have to say hey, that whenever it's Arthur. Great talk, Andrew. You mentioned biblical quotations. Are there post-biblical rabbinic medical sources mentioned or alluded to? Thank you.
Short answer is no. And Arthur, I don't know exactly why. He certainly, given his age and when he lived and where he lived, he would have had an education in rabbinic sources and knew his Talmud and Midrash. My suspicion is that as someone who went to an Italian university medical faculty, he wasn't as interested in Talmudic and post-Talmudic medicine from Jewish sources as he was in Galen and Hippocrates and commentaries on them that he had read and studied as a medical student. So the language of the Bible completely permeates his mind. But when it comes to medical data and medical terminology, I don't think that he's going to turn to Talmudic medical anecdotes in order to diagnose or discuss things he's seeing in his practice.
I have two questions here in the front and one in the left side, my life.
All right, my question has to do with Tiber River water. And I know that very slightly later in the century, there's a huge debate among physicians about whether you should drink it, whether it's good to drink or not. And the popes from Clement the VII on carried it with them when they went anywhere, and other physicians thought it was a horrible mistake. So in your letters, do you find this debate at all? They're a little earlier.
He doesn't write about potable water at all that I've seen. He only complains about bread, which I think is in one of those excerpts that I gave you. He talks about how hard the bread is to chew, how it makes him and other people constipated. Hamlet, it's been a while since I've read Bacci on the Tiber, but he also, Andrea Bacci, whose title page I showed, I believe, and I could be wrong, I believe his conclusion is that the Tiber River water from Rome, southwest to Ostia, is dangerous and should be avoided, but north of Rome, it's cleaner and purer and should be drunk.
Right, I think that's right about that, yeah.
Thank you. I have two small questions, one for each of you, for papers with much bigger perspectives. Petros, your paper, I just had I was very interested in the idea of this, the way this is this text is being added to, not in marginalia, not in glosses or things being incorporated by later scribes, but somehow inserted in that way. So I was interested in that process that you asked, how is it going on? So I was just wondering, looking at that page you showed us, it somehow looks a little bit compressed. And I was wondering if there are any indications or like counting the lines or a sort of not quite fitting the ruling or something that might indicate a sort of on the fly intervention rather than the sort of rough copy being then copied out again.
No, I think it's coincidental.
Okay, it looks, so yeah. I was just seeing it wrong. Okay,
good point, but not in the manuscript.
Okay, interesting. And the other very small point then that I had for Andrew Berns is just a question out of ignorance. It looks like the picture of Stimigliano is taken from the lower slopes of Monte Amiata and from the Sant'Andrea in Fiumine. Is that true from that monastery?
As far as I know, I got it from Google. I got it from Google Images.
Ah, okay. Well, so my question is,
makes sense.
So my question is about the monastery then. Is the monastery, because I don't know if it's still important or anything, is it a big landholder there? Are his clientele working on land owned by the monastery? Are they a player?
The short, honest answer is I don't know, but I'm so grateful for the question because that would add an entire dimension to this project. So
I mean, I don't know if they're even, I'd be interested. Thank you.
Thank you. First of all, thank you both. My question goes for Dr. Berns. Is there any evidence of anti-Semitism for, especially for an itinerant doctor, given that by the Cinquecento, the Roman ghetto was already established?
Short answer is no, and you're absolutely right. The Roman ghetto was established in 1517, which is right around the time he's writing. In fact, one of these letters dates, so we think, from that very year. He complains about cold, about expenses, about the pharmacists on being on vacation, about people being stingy, as you heard me say and you saw yourself, but he never says anything about anti-Semitic accusations or treatment. On the contrary, his affirmations of self-importance seem to suggest either the opposite or certainly the absence of anti-Semitism. They love me, they honor me, they consider me one of their own. And this could be self-presentation rather than any reflection of reality, but I see nothing in these letters pointing toward anti-Semitism.
Thank you both for two great papers. And I have a quick question, also one for each of you. We'll start with Petros. Sort of related to your question, I just wondered whether there's any indication of if there any transition from these kind of interpolations into the text that it's interrupting, or it's just
no indication.
So it's not say, oh, now back to what I was, back to the text, or any,
there's no. A usual chapter title like we find on the main chapters of the treatise.
Right. Okay. Thank you.
It is intentional. To be included.
Yeah.
Without showing to the reader that it's an addition.
Right, I see. Fascinating.
My impression from this manuscript.
Great.
Yes.
Yeah, he said, right.
He says, yes.
And then he just goes back, yeah.
On the other hand, in the way that they said the manuscript, they would like to show that it's an integral part of the translation.
Yeah, so interesting.
There is a translation, so there is a new text that becomes available in Greek. At the same time, we have these additions making entirely new text. And there is no indication, apart from this mention to his name or to his son, there is no indication, the folio they use the same kind of chapter titles, the same scribe. So it's an intentional way of making this integral part of the translation.
That's great. Thank you. And Andrew, you had mentioned classical sources in the background. Are they in your notes here, did you say, or just in your, okay, I was looking for the back. And you mentioned Galen. You said, is there any mention of any sources here?
Not.
Is there any mention in particular of Hippocrates, Galen would have been looking back to Hippocrates on airs, waters, places, and things like that. So, is that he must, if he's university trained, he must be aware of that, right? But it doesn't make it into the letters.
Okay. No, but given my knowledge of other Italian Jewish medical writings of this period,
yeah,
I have seen plenty of citations of Galen and Hippocrates. You're right in pointing out that he's probably less familiar with Hippocrates than Galen.
Yeah,
Sorice and Vivian Nutton have pointed out, it really isn't until the publication of the Aldine Hippocrates bit later in the 16th century that Hippocrates is read and studied by medical students or by the Grecophone population. But again, that was an applied observation given my knowledge of other texts. Solomon himself doesn't cite Galen, Hippocrates, or any other
or anyone,
Roman medical.
They've authority. Just internalized it all. Yeah, that's fascinating. Great, thank you.
Check it with Dot real quick.
Any questions? Dot?
Okay.
Yes, thanks for two excellent papers. And I've just got a quick question for Andrew. I'd just like to know more, a lot more, actually. You may just be at the beginning stages of this, about Medici Condotti and what the motivation is for hiring them, how they're paid, since it seems to be kind of a combination of an appointment salary and then they're paid per visit or something that is by the patients, but they wouldn't be there I mean, there would be no condotto if they weren't being paid something by, in this case, the Ursini. What do we know about the motivation for people like the Ursini to bring a physician in to an area like this or any other? That is, are there specific things that they're trying to guard against? Is this a general kind of public health development that's happening? That if you're going to be a good lord, that's part of lording, or what? What's going on with that? What do we know?
A couple of things are going on with this. One is a desire to have somebody on site all the time who can address public health issues, especially if those public health issues result in less productive labor forces. And it's clear that that's part of what Solomon's noticing around the Tiber River. So I would bet, and the little bit of scholarship I've read confirms this, that having a medical authority on staff present all the time is, in capitalist terms, is going to make the laboring people more productive, or at least less ill, less often. The other thing that's going on here is a desire to elevate the town to the status of a place that's significant enough to, it seems to be a kind of campanilismo situation where they, the Orsini, want to say Stimiliano is as important as Morlupa because look, we have a doctor. And Anne, even though you didn't ask this, the other side of the question, it seems to me, is why would Solomon have gone there? And in letter two, I think he says that he's offered permanent lodgings in the home of the Fattore for the Orsini family, and he rejects it. He doesn't say why he rejects it, but my estimate is that he would have said no because it would have put him under the thumb of this Fattore, sort of a factotum, he does say that. And he probably wanted to strike out on his own and take individual clients. So in other words, there's a balance of being paid either in kind or in cash as a official town doctor, and also wanting to earn additional money seeing his own patients.
Question that I think applies to both of these papers, but it was sparked by Solomon's amazing letters. And it's just so striking that, as Andrew said, he uses biblical terminology and imagery rather than Galenic, rather than bringing up his university training in these letters. And I wonder if there's a way we can talk about the refusal to translate, where someone who is eminently capable of moving between different registers, different idioms, different traditions, who just chooses not to do that.
Do you also have a question for Petros? Or was
I just... think it applies.
Okay. Yeah, I'll go first and I'll try to be very succinct, Petros, and I'd love to hear your thoughts too. My simplest answer to this, Eric, is that he's writing for posterity as much as he's writing to his fiance Bianca or his teacher. And he could have flexed, as the kids say now, used Greek terms to describe an illness. But I think he knew, he hoped that his letters would serve as a model for future letter writers. And he didn't want to show off excessively by using Greek if, in the next generation, a Hebrew writer hadn't studied medicine to an Italian university faculty, but still wanted to write to their teacher or their father or fiance. So I'm guessing socio-experiential factors are the explanation there.
What's your question? I'm not sure.
Just about the refusal to translate it. What are the choices?
Yes, I think that the only way is that there is no translation. It's for some substances that there are no words in Greek. So what they do is to transliterate usually, or to give sometimes to give some Greek synonyms. And in some cases, we can see the reapplication of ancient forgotten terms. This is the case of Mirobalanos, for example. It was used for a plant which was imported from Egypt in the ancient world. At some point, the term was not used. And here is reapplied for a new substance coming from Southern Asia. So the species of Myrobala of the Terminalia genus. So when there's a refuse to translate, it's because I think there is no terminology in Greek. And what he does is to transliterate or to reapply past terms, which have not been used for ages.
I actually, just to piggyback off of Eric's question, Andrew, it strikes me that in fact, then there's a third type of translation, and maybe this is the flip side of Eric, your question. So there's the translation from urban to rural, as you say, there's the translation from, you know, highly theorized text-based like Latin theoretical medicine into Hebrew. But then it seems like there's a third level of translation, which is translating in some way or not the medical knowledge that he has into biblical terms. Mm-hmm. So I just want to kind of think about like, what does it mean when you are translating from like that, that also is a set of choices that get made. Yeah. So I just wanted to kind of, I don't know, invite you to kind of muse upon that.
Sure. I want to point out that literacy rates for Italian Jews at the turn of the 16th century are extremely high. Even for women and girls, they're about 95%. Often, women and girls don't know how to write in Latin characters, but they do know how to write in Hebrew characters. So in some ways, I don't know how to say this without having it sound vaguely poetic. The verbal architecture of their minds is Hebraic. Mm-hmm. And the way they think about describing experiences in a literary way, this is maybe a kind of diglossia, that in their spoken communication, they're speaking whatever the local Italian vernacular is, but in their epistolography, it's always Hebrew. So I think in many ways, the first expression that came to the pen would have been biblical slash Hebrew, but verbally in discussing an illness or a plant or a treatment with someone else, it almost certainly would have been Romance.
I think I saw
I just had a quick question for Petros. Apologies, I had to step out a little bit just at the very end, so you might have already mentioned this, but I know you write and think a lot about diagrams, visual diagrams in this material, and I wonder if you could just say a bit about paratexts and diagrams as paratextual and paratexts as diagrammatic, and how the two interplay, if you have any thoughts on that.
Yes, I think that we can easily consider diagrams as paratexts when they are added to explicate or to facilitate the understanding of the reader, especially in the margins or around the main text. But then it has to do on how you define paratext. I mean, and it depends also on the folio layout. In these manuscripts, in this particular manuscript, there are no diagrams. But there are other medical manuscripts that you can find various kinds of diagrams as paratextual elements, especially in the margins. I mean, anatomical diagrams. You can find also tree diagrams, various kinds of diagrams. Yes, it's. I think there's no much scholarship, especially in the Greek tradition, and I think. That it is important to try to do some research on this all these notes and all these paratextual elements which have not been studied because they were simply considered not functional or of no use by philologists and editors. But I think now that we have many texts, it's time to start looking at this material, and sometimes can be very helpful in contextualizing these copies, these treatises on their actual environment.
If I may, my question is also for Petros. I was thinking about the way you framed, I think quite rightly, the location of this manuscript production in either southern Italy or in Sicily, in the tip of right on either side of the straits. And I think you're completely right to do that, but I wonder if you could also contextualize this for us a bit in terms of what it might say or how it might revise some of the received narratives of the transmission of natural sciences or knowledge and medicine, or sort of our old narrative of, you know, from the Greeks to the Arabs to Europe, and also the revised version, which is from the Greeks to the Arabs, who did lots of innovative things, and then to Europe in Latin. Can you say a bit about what this evidence might change in that?
That's a good question, I think, which is very important. We know about these translation movements, but nobody has studied the minor translation movements. I mean, there are so many translations going on in medieval Mediterranean, and one of these is the translation from Arabic into Greek. There is no specific place, and there is no specific point of time, as it is with the Arabo-Greek, the Greco-Arabic or the Arabo-Latin, which they happen in a specific place and in a specific period of time. We know that, for example, translation from Arabic into Greek for medical treatises took place from the 10th, 11th century to the 15th century in various places. And I think that what is important in this case is to take in consideration the place, because this is also the place of a little bit northern major translations from Arabic into Latin at the same period. And what is important, I think, in contextualizing these things is to consider the importance of this area as sort of contact zone between various populations. I mean, you have Greek-speaking physicians, you have Roman-speaking, Latin-speaking, you have Jewish, you have Arabs, especially in Sicily. So all these connections, I think, are very important. And we have to start looking at these regions and at this region and this, in a more wider way, because we usually think that is important region for the translations from Arabic into Latin. But we know that we have at least four medical translations from Arabic into Greek. They took place at this place, and they were later disseminated in proper Byzantium. At that point, we have major Greek-speaking populations at this place. I mean, entire cities and villages that are solely Greek-speaking. And the translations were disseminated into the Byzantium proper quite later, I mean, from the 13th century onwards. In terms of the wider picture, I think it is important to consider that some elements of Arabic medicine, for example, became available in Byzantium before they became available in Europe. As I have argued in my recent article, sugar-based potions and Arabic innovation and innovation of Islamic medicine became available in Byzantium already by the 9th, 10th century, and in Europe only by the late 11th century. So we have to reconsider several ways of looking at the transmission of knowledge from the Islamic world to Europe by including the role of Byzantium, the role of minorities, the role of Jewish communities. They played an important role, especially from the 12th century onwards. And this is something we need, I think, to revise, not only looking at medicine, but also astronomical texts, alchemical texts, other kinds of, to revise all this old-fashioned, I would say, way of looking and the transmission only from Arabic into Latin, by including wider evidence for broader medieval topics like medical practice, astronomy, and other topics.
Well, this is a thrilling engagement with the very heart of translating science. I think this is enormously inspiring. The bad news is we've exhausted our time for this particular discussion, so let's take it into the break and thank our speakers.